seated. Welcome to this memorial service where we give thanks for the life of Anthony Lane Edwards, the legacy, lessons, and love he leaves behind, and the resurrection from his life to this life to the next. He leaves a huge hole in our hearts, especially for his wife Shelley, sons Connor and Hunter, Hunter's wife, and Lane's daughter-in-law Kaylee, brother Jeff, sister-in-law Dawn, along with their children, father Charles and their families, along with his friends and colleagues, many of which are gathered here today. Thank you for joining us this afternoon, for your presence shows all of Lane's family just how many lives he touched, and so many more. Just by being here, you are surrounding them and all of Lane's friends and family with God's love. The coronavirus may not have allowed Lane to live longer than September 23rd, 2021 with us, but he will never be defined by it. The same is true about diabetes and even a heart attack that almost took him from us following a successful kidney and pancreas transplant in November 2019. His older brother and longtime business partner, Jeff, described Lane to me this week as having 9 lives. No one knows how much he went through because he never complained. Charles echoed that same sentiment. Lane shared with me how important his family, especially you, Shelley, and both you, Hunter and Connor, meant to him. Kaylee, he loved you and celebrated when you married Hunter. He talked so much about that. Jeff and Dawn, you know Lane maybe as well as anyone. And Charles, Mr. Edwards, I have no words. And I may not make it. That's why I have my friend Erica here with me today. Only love to share with you, and lots of it. May the buttressing effect of all the circle of friends and family that surrounded Lane in his life and surely increased his fortitude and his fight and all his health issues also support each of you. We're all a part of Lane, as it is clear today, he was all a part of us. Son, brother, husband, cousin, uncle, friend, coach, colleague, partner, teammate, and so much more. His relationships, that's what defines him. In Africa, they call it Ubuntu. I am because we are. I am because we are. Lane was born and raised in Monroe, the second son and child of Patricia and Charles Edward, and almost 6 years younger than his brother Jeff. I believe he went to East Elementary School to start off with, if I'm right, and then the family moved to Stack Road, just south of Monroe, and Lane transferred to Walter Bickett, where many gathered here in the Monroe High School class of 1985. We said, come alive in 85, including myself. Met him in Miss Strickland's fourth grade class, and she was strict. We learned field hockey, by the way, Erica, in Miss Strickland's fourth grade class. That's a story for another time. Lane was extremely smart and athletic. He was a especially good baseball player, where his dad coached him and he shifted his attention to tennis and golf in high school. In fact, it was on the golf course, and I was with him, when he first began to self-diagnose his diabetes. Lane making a diagnosis is probably not surprising to most who knew him, because he was a researcher and sharp, critical thinker. He also was a hard worker and entrepreneur. His first job was at Village Square Movie Theater. Lane, along with David Belk, Bran Acock, and others, I should remember, may or may not have opened the theater to friends the night before the SATs and prom night, for a free midnight movie that could have been followed by some breakdancing in the parking lot and behind the theater on a 10 by 10 piece of linoleum that Lane seemed to carry around in his car. Lane was always in fashion, and at that prom the next day, he moonwalked in a white dinner jacket, black slacks, and you better believe it, white gloves. Rusty Williams, who had some moves of his own back then, wore those white gloves too to the prom, verified to me this week that Lane was able to spin on his head breakdancing. One summer, he worked the Color Purple film nearby, and Lane was the award-winning director Steven Spielberg's driver, many of us know. He met so many famous people. That makes my head spin. He attended the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill and was a member, along with Brian Smith, Greg Hoffman, Christian Weil, and others, of Sigma Epsilon fraternity. He loved that brotherhood so much, and Carolina generally. He followed Tar Heel sports religiously. Lane also loved music and movies. Those of you who still have your Mohisco yearbook, go back and read what he wrote in your yearbook. I did this week. Mine starts this way. Home chicka-wee, chicka-chicka-wee, Pac-Man, Pac-Jam, homeboy. That's the way it started. I love that guy. Although he danced to rap and hip-hop, Journey, according to Connor, was his favorite band and jam in the car. That makes sense to me because Journey might have been his first concert at the old Charlotte Coliseum. I think it's called Bojangles Coliseum now. I drove by today. By the way, if anyone bought and still has one of those mixtapes that Lane and Rusty Williams made and sold for a legal donation, they just went up in value. Anybody have one of those still? Lane loved to go to the coast. In fact, the portrait feature today is from the Sea Captain's house in Myrtle Beach, which is right across the street from a home we vacationed in for many years. Connor told me this week that his dad loved homes. I thought that was really interesting. His dad loved homes. I think I know why. He loved being home with his family and friends. He wanted everyone to have a home. You see, Lane built homes for 20 years and then sold them for the rest of his working life. Most of that time, it was with his mother's Tarleton family, and then in partnership with his brother Jeff. They called it the Edwards Building Group. Lane, you see, he knew how to build a house and a home. He knew how to build friendships and businesses and a marriage and a family. He knew how to sell a house too, and he did that as a realtor with RE/MAX in his last few years. He met Shelley in the early 1990s, and they were married at Central United Methodist Church here in Monroe in 93. She remembers noticing his beautiful eyes weeks before they met. They changed color, she said, with his shirt, she told me. Sometimes blue, sometimes hazel, but mostly green. Together, they were gifted with Hunter in 1995 and Connor in 1998. He prioritized his time with them as dad and coach, baseball, soccer, and basketball. I'm not sure why he didn't coach football, because he and I had figured out how to run the triple option with two-on-two fully padded football games against Cord Goodson and Dan Paris. And if you can run a triple option with two people, you got to be brilliant. There's only really one option, right? Two options there. But he loved his sons. Like Lane, he mentored them, and they worked in a movie theater too. If y'all didn't notice the music today, movie themes. Lane kept coaching even after his kids aged out. And to some, he was the only coach they remembered, Hunter told me. Lane is clearly worth remembering, and that's what we're here to do today. May this be only, though, the first of many celebrations of his life, when we gather, when we honor him with the ways we build friendships, families, homes, teams, how we treat our dogs. He loved all his canine family and is surely playing now with Charlie and Adolph and Duncan and Charlie. There were two Charlies. And Annie, and missing Ollie, the dog they adopted just last March, not long after he returned from the hospital and his transplants and five ICU visits. Lane went to a Presbyterian summer camp on the North Carolina coast, Camp Albemarle, but he was baptized as a teenager at his family's church, Macedonia Baptist Church. That baptism now is complete. He has died to the Lord and risen with Christ Jesus. So I welcome you all and invite you to join me in giving thanks to God for the life of Anthony Lane Edwards. My name's Lee Henson Hasty, and I'm assisted by my close friend, the Reverend Erica Funk. It's an honor and a privilege for us to preside today for this celebration.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship that you will see on the screen behind me. Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest.
Amen.
Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in prayer. Creator of us all, you gave us birth. You know our hearts deeply and are always more ready to hear than we are to turn to you. You know what we most long for even before we have the words to offer. At this time, as we face the mystery of death, help us see your grace and the light of eternity. Reassure us once more of your promises of life, death, and resurrection, even as we give thanks for the great company of all those who have kept the faith, finished their race, and who now rest from this human life. We thank you for our loved ones who have gone before us. You know how much we miss them and the hole they have left in our hearts, even as we say goodbye to Lane. For those of us still walking this earth, help us to believe, even when we have not seen with our own eyes, that you are leading us and holding us close in the arms of love. When our time in this life is over, bring us into the joy of all your saints, reunited with Lane and all our loved ones, into our true home with Jesus Christ. Amen. Please join me in reading aloud a unison reading of Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. The Lord lets me rest in grassy meadows. The Lord leads me to restful waters. The Lord keeps me alive. The Lord guides me in proper paths for the sake of God's good name. Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no danger because you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they protect me. You set a table for me right in front of my enemies. You bathe my head in oil. My cup is so full, it spills over. Yes, goodness and faithful love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the Lord's house as long as I live. Listen now for a word from God in our scripture reading. The first is from Romans chapter 8, verses 35, 38, and 39. Who will separate us from Christ's love? Will we be separated by trouble or distress or harassment or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? I'm convinced that nothing can separate us from God's love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Not death or life, not angels or rulers, not present things or future things, not powers or height or depth or any other thing that is created. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verse 8b, chapter 2, verse 20, and chapter 3, verse 10 and 11. I'll give a little background of these. During the annual Jewish Feast of Weeks, Shavuot in Hebrew, the spring harvest is celebrated, and all four chapters of the book of Ruth are read aloud. I'll not take the 15 minutes today needed to do that, but I would like to draw our attention to these verses I've mentioned, one from each of the first three chapters. As the story of Ruth begins and ends, you're in Bethlehem, that legendary small town, dozens of generations before Jesus was born there. The word Beth, the first part of that, means house in Hebrew, and Lehem means bread. So in chapter 1, verse 1, we learn that this town that we might call a house of bread, that bread basket is empty because there is a famine. Because of the famine, Elimelech and his wife Naomi moved to a foreign land, Moab. By the beginning of chapter 2, we learn that Bethlehem hosts a full barley harvest again. It's a story, you see, of emptiness to fullness to emptiness, and back and forth. In the second verse, we learn they have two sons. In the third verse, we learn that Elimelech, which means my God and my King, my God and my King, he dies. In verse 4, the sons marry Moabite wives. In verse 5, both of those sons die. See what I mean? Emptiness to fullness. And then Naomi decides she should return to Bethlehem, back to her family, back to her roots. Both of her widowed daughters-in-law go with her, as was customary. Naomi then instructs them in a strong speech in verse 8 to stay there in Moab and not return with her, saying, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me." Take note of the words in bold and underline. The Hebrew word here is hesed, and it is translated and used a bit differently in each of the verses that I will share today. One of the daughters-in-law, Orpah, does turn back with a promise of being dealt kindly with by God, but Ruth, no, she remains with Naomi on the journey to Bethlehem. In a dramatic speech, after repeated urges to stay by Naomi, Ruth puts her foot down and says, "Don't urge me to abandon you, to turn back from following you. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people. Your God, my God. Wherever you die, I will die. And there I will be buried. May the Lord do this to me, and more so, even if death separates me from you." When Naomi saw that Ruth was determined to go with her, she stopped speaking about it. In chapter 2, when they do return to Bethlehem, their harvest is happening, as I spoke about earlier. As widows, both are granted gleaning privileges. They didn't own any land, of course, but they're able to go glean what is left in the field that the farmers do not take. But that doesn't last long, as Ruth is noticed by one of Naomi's distant family members, Boaz, who makes sure some extra bales are left behind for her and her mother-in-law, Naomi. In verse 20 of chapter 2, Naomi says to her daughters-in-law, "Blessed be Boaz by the Lord, whose kindness," that's hesed again, "has not forsaken the living or the dead." Shelley, maybe it was Ruth's gorgeous eyes that Boaz noticed. I don't know. But whatever it is, kindness, hesed, would bless them both as a gift from God through Boaz. Other translations say loving kindness or steadfast love. It's a sustainable, lifelong sort of love. It's the kind of love that builds relationships that last long. The kind of relationships that Lane also nurtured in his life. Relationships that felt like an open-armed welcome hug home. By chapter 3, Ruth deepens her relationship with Boaz, and as a result, he takes full responsibility for her and Naomi, saying, "May you, Ruth, be blessed by the Lord, my daughter. This last instance of your loyalty," there's Hesed again, "is better than the first. You have not gone after young men, whether poor or rich. And now, my daughter, do not be afraid. I will do for you all that you ask, and all the assembly of my people know that you are a worthy woman." Loyalty, that's Hesed. That's Ruth again. Loyalty may be why each of us find ourselves participating and sitting here today. Lane's Hesed, his loyalty, his kindness, his steadfastness. Because you see, like Ruth, Lane Edwards was resourceful, clever, a risk taker, future oriented, resilient. Gosh, he was resilient. And maybe most of all, loving, kind, and loyal. Hesed. Like Ruth, Lane could convince anyone to do just about anything. Am I right? That usually worked out for the best, but please don't ask me later about why I agreed to drive his white Toyota Tercel and it ended up in the body shop on New Year's Day, 1986. Sorry, Charles. No one was physically harmed, but we certainly, our egos were bruised for sure. Which makes me wonder if he was the one that dreamed up breaking into the new First Presbyterian Church gym to play basketball one weekend. We had so much fun. Who was there? Anybody there in the gym? Oh, good. I got a few takers. Yeah, maybe he was the one. I don't know, but I digress. Or maybe not. Because Ruth is now associated with an annual festival, and I feel like every time I was with Lane, we were having fun like it was a festival. Lane's journey, like Ruth's, was full of twists and turns. For him, it was a hard-fought battle with insulin-dependent diabetes to dialysis for years, a long-awaited transplant that he prayed for, a heart attack, and many other things, and then COVID. Ruth never imagined leaving Moab, I'm sure. I suspect she didn't see anything coming that happened to her, but she made adjustments. Lane did too. Ruth never expected her husband to die at a young age, or leaving a foreign land with her mother-in-law to go to Israel and Bethlehem. But she was loyal and she was resilient. Boaz, a redemptive presence in their life who gave them food and then a promise to take care of them, was a gift also that she did not see coming. It's this idea of a gift that has me probably hurting the most today. I don't know about you, but I think I took the gift of Lane Edwards in my life for granted. Him leaving this world this soon is clearly not what I or any of us wanted. And I'll just say, I don't think it's what God wanted either. But we're going to be resilient and loving and kind and future-oriented anyway. Like Ruth and like Lane, you see, we're called to make adjustments, or some really dangerous things could happen. Lives are at stake, including our own. In 2010... my wife and I were in Hungary. She was teaching on a Fulbright scholarship there. And we learned a lot while we were there. We learned about the resiliency of the Hungarians, the cleverness, the loyalty, the loving nature of who they were, the kind of culture of the Hungarians. They were honest, just like this sign before a hairpin turn on the adjacent Tietze River. It told you what was going to happen. You just kind of had to follow the signs. Sometimes we have to follow those signs and make adjustments. Hungarians have been occupied and ruled by Austrians, Germans, and Russians, and that's just the last 100 years. The museum pictured here is the former Nazi headquarters in Budapest, its capital city. It's called the Terrorháza, or House of Terror. Painful stories of the past are remembered here. One of my questions going to Hungary and to the Terrorháza remains with me. How did they survive all those occupations? The only answer is that I have is they had each other. In my faith, it's the body of Christ in which we're all a part of as children of God. It's the only reason I think Lane stayed the course and got so much on borrowed time. It's because of those who loved him. Shelley, you fought with him. And Hunter, and Charles, and Connor, and Jeffrey, and Dawn, and Kaylee. His doctors, his nurses, his colleagues, others, we fought with him. That's why he made it. We have all of you to thank. In the city center of Debrecen, it's called Calvin Tear. The great church is there as a reminder that God is at the center of all that kind of love and support, the center of gravity, the center of our lives, even when we forget. So this is an architectural echo, you see, of Ruth's loyalty oath to Naomi. Your people are my people. Your God is my God. Where you stay, I will stay. Where you die, I will die. There I will be also. Where you live, I will live. Well, I added that last sentence because that's not something that Naomi says about where you live, I will live. But the rest of the book of Ruth says that. Where you live, I will live, because she does it. And that's our call, I think, too, to live out Hesed by living where we live, by loving and being kind and loyal. That's what Hesed is, with God at the center of that life. When you step back from the church, in front of the great church, they added about 20 years ago to that place that's been there for over 500 years, that church that is pictured in the background, they added this phoenix rising from the ashes. Ruth rose like this. Christ Jesus rose like this. And today we're here to celebrate and give thanks for the mystery and the truth that our brother Lane is rising to new life like this, from emptiness and death and ashes to fullness and flight and new life. May we all gathered here who are feeling that emptiness, have you felt that emptiness? May we know the fullness that is to come, even with an untimely death that we have experienced. May we know the new life today, now, or soon, and in the days to come, the fullness of life that God offers us, particularly in God's gathered community. May we be resilient and loyal, kind, and loving and steadfast, and know in our head and in our heart, God, for God's sake, will deal kindly with each of us. I promise you. May it be this day and always. And all God's people said, Amen.
Join your hearts with mine, and let us be in prayer. O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your children who now live eternally in your love. Especially we thank you for Lane and praise you for the gift of his life, for everything in him that was good and kind and faithful, for his quick, dry wit and his wild intelligence, the ways he built a home with Shelley and homes for so, so many others with his brother Jeff. Thank you for his hesed, steadfast, loving kindness, his loyalty, his resilience, his humility, positive attitude, and love for others. We do thank you that for him, death is past and pain has ended, that he now has full life in you. We know that you now hold him close as he finds his new room at home with you and show you how to expand that home for others. Those of us here in these human bodies, in this human life, we ask that you take the burden and weight of our heavy sorrow. We ask that your hope, grace, and strength be with us as we walk this earthly journey through this human life until the day you call us home and we are reunited in the life to come in Christ. And hear us now as we pray together as Jesus taught his disciples with the translation shown on the screen. Heavenly Father, Heavenly Mother, holy and blessed is your true name. We pray for your reign of peace to come. We pray that your good will be done. Let heaven and earth become one. Give us this day the bread we need. Give it to those who have none. Let forgiveness flow like a river between us, from each one to each one. Lead us to holy innocence beyond the evil of our lot. Come swiftly, Mother, Father, come. For yours is the power and the glory and the mercy. Forever your name is all in one. Amen.
Let us pray. Oh Lord, you only are immortal, for you are the creator and maker of all, who poured out your love to shape all creation and all creatures. Yet all creatures, including us, are mortal. We are formed of the earth, and the earth, our bodies will return, even as you said, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Yet with all our being, even at the grave, we sing our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. For your hands we commend your beloved child, Anthony Lane Edwards, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a son of your own heart. Receive him into your merciful arms, into the light of all eternity, with all your saints. In Christ's name we pray, and all God's people said, Amen. And now I pray as we go from this place, we will give thanks and move from emptiness to fullness in how we live our lives, and how we share what we knew of who Lane was. May we build homes for others and take care of our own home. May we love one another steadfastly. And you know, never forget just to notice people's eyes. You never know who you might meet next who could be a lifelong friend. And may the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the circle of God's love. And may you remember the power of grace to heal the past, to give strength to the present, hope for the future, until the day you too are called home in Christ. This we pray in the name of the one who created us, the one who redeemed us, the one who sustains us, day by day, breath by breath. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Please stand.